very warm welcome to the Lit Fest, a literally leap, where wit means spontaneity and intellect intertwines with eloquence.
Today, we embark on a journey through the enchanting realm of language and imagination. Let's come together to honor the diverse expressions of creativity and competing in the poetry competition for grade 5, speech competition for grade 6, example for grade 7, and the debate and Shakespeare and monologue for grade 8, where every voice has a story to tell and a dream to share.
I am Aruhi Aryapralatka with my fellow anchor,
Jia Vaidya, here to guide you through this event.
In a world where opinions abound and perspectives vary, the art of speaking becomes a beacon of connections and understanding. It's a tool with which the bridge divides, builds alliances, and navigates the complexities of human interactions. Before we commence our activities, it's time to seek the blessings of Almighty, connect with our spirits, for the higher power, and get the wisdom.
Let's all take a moment, close our eyes and bring ourselves to a calm and peaceful state. Let's forget about all the hassles of life and focus on the tranquility within us.
We're absolutely honored to invite our esteemed guest, our Director Principal Ma'am, Mr. Our Middle Section Coordinator, to officially inaugurate our event and to seek the blessings of Almighty. I would also like to invite the choir on stage. The members are Trisha Kedia from Class 8D, Vedika Jain from Class 7A, Liana Vagasia from Class 7A, Kiara Solanki from Class 7B, and Kushali Jaju from Class 5D.
Heartfelt thanks to our guests, Miss Kanika Davar, Director Principal Ma'am, and our coordinator for leading this auspicious beginning. With this luminous start, we will now officially declare this event open and proceed with our planned schedule.
Now, I would like to call all the students who are participating for the Extempo competition. They'll be picking the chits for the selected topics. I would also like Nilima ma'am to be there on the stage. All the extempore students, please stand up and come on the stage.
Reveal your topics.
Is homework beneficial or detrimental for to students' learning?
Yes, detrimental. Your topic is?
Corruption and its effects on human rights.
Okay. Is homework beneficial or detrimental to students' learning?
Detrimental.
Is climate change the greatest threat to our planet? Okay.
Journey is more important than destination.
Okay. Opportunity comes only once.
To err is human, to forgive is divine.
Is climate change the greatest threat to our planet? To err is human, to forgive divine. Journey is more important than destination.
Okay, so all our extempore kids have got their topics. Now they will be preparing under the guidance of teacher.
Thank you to all the students. Now, allow me to introduce our judge who will evaluate our talented finalists. We are honored and privileged to have with us today
our first judge, our judge, Ms. Kanika Davar. Kanika Davar, a teacher by choice and educator by passion, is a founder and chief mentor of Owl Academy, a leading institute in Surat dedicated to enhancing English language skills, with two centers in Vesu and Bhatar and certified courses from the University of Cambridge. Owl Academy also partners with local schools to broaden its reach.
Kanika Ma'am's mission is to transform English learning into a fun, practical and experimental process. She has successfully trained over 2,000 learners in public speaking, elocution, extempore and debating, observing that children in Surat city struggles with English compared to their peers in metro. She was inspired to bridge this gap.
Kanika Ma'am's innovative methods aim to boost students' confidence and equip them with the skills needed to compete with children from any city or state. Through her dedication, she is revolutionizing English education in Surat, making it enjoyable and impactful for young learners.
We would like to call Ms. Kanika Ma'am with our Director Principal Ma'am to felicitate her. A huge round of applause, audience. Can we keep the plots going? Now I would like to call our Director Principal Ma'am, Ms. Jayashi Chararia, for her words of the wisdom.
A big thank you to Arohi and Jia for taking up the anchoring part. And a very good morning to all the dear parents present here, all my students out there. It's such a thing to see, and so affectionate I feel when I see my children out there looking for your peers to participate. And you must take this as that next time you will be on this stage and selected. But before I start, we have monologues from Shakespeare, I would just like to address some lines from Shakespeare technique, and just forgive me if I've made some mistake, but then I've just given it a try because this is the way we can even motivate our children. Friends, teachers, students and dear parents, lend me your ears. Forsooth we gather here this morn, in halls of learning where minds doth weave a tapestry of knowledge fair, wrought with diligence beyond compare. Oh, how like the bard's enchanted page doth each lesson stir, each passage engage. From the tempest of science to the soliloquy of art, we embark on a journey hand in heart. Behold the scholars with dreams in their heart, braving the tests, the challenges grant, like actors, debaters, and reciters upon a wondrous stage, they perform feats with wisdom as their wage. But hark, what light through yonder window breaks? 'Tis the warden of understanding, no mistakes. For in this realm of books and lore, we find the keys to open wisdom's door. So let us raise our voices high and sing the praises of learning nigh. For in the pursuit of knowledge fair, we find a purpose beyond compare. And this is what we want our children, that it is very important to participate. Winning or not winning can be a goal, but not the end of the goal. So this is what it is. We want our children for the exposure of the stage and the way they can compete with outside world apart from school. As we gather here today, I want to take a moment of reflect on the journey we've been on together. When I say together, I mean my students and my parents, because these two stakeholders are very much important for them to gather with the other stakeholder, the teacher and the school. It's a community. It's not just a building. That is a G.D.Goenka, a place where ideas are exchanged, friendships are forged and futures are shaped. Each one of you brings something unique to our school, whether you are a student, a teacher or a staff member or a parent. Your talents, your passions, and your dedication are what make this place special. I want to thank my teachers for their tireless efforts in educating and inspiring our students. Their commitment to excellence does not go unnoticed, and it is because of them that our students have the opportunity to reach their full potential. Finally, to my parents and guardians, thank you for entrusting us with the education of your children. Your support and involvement are invaluable, and we are grateful for the partnerships we share in shaping the future generation. We move forward. Let us continue to work together to create a school environment where every individual feels valued, respected, and supported. And a very big thank you to all the parents who took all these pains for the children to come on Sundays and Saturdays whenever we call them for these particular rehearsals. Because during the school hours only we are doing these rehearsals where children are very much happy to participate, and we can see that excitement when you see the poem recitations, the way they debate, the way they put on the monologues, and the way the parents of their children have participated in this wonderful event. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am, for your inspiring words.
We'll start with our first competition for the day. From sonnet structures in need to free verse with boundless fleet, each poet's voice a melody in the symphony of poetry.
So poets, pen your first lines, let your thoughts become designs. For in this competition's domain, beauty and depth shall reign.
Today, our fifth graders have some poems in store for us, which they will recite.
They will be judged on the following criteria: pace, fluency, expressions, stress, intonations, and Vandana ma'am will be keeping the time for them. We would like to wish our participants the best of luck, and let's invite our first participant, Vanshika Mehta from class 5th A. Can we have a huge round of applause for her?
Good morning to one and all present over here. Today, I, Vanshika Mihir Mehta, I'm going to recite a poem called Gratitude to Almighty, which is written by myself. Hey Almighty, hey Almighty, we all are your children. You have given us brains which help reach great heights to education. You have made this planet, Mother Earth is what we call. You have given us grains which help us to be strong. You have given us trees which help us to breathe. Each resource you give all help us to live. You have given us blessings which help us get fine earnings. You have gifted us parents and the whole family beside who ensure we are healthy and have a powerful mind. Thank you.
Thank you, Vanshika, for writing such a beautiful poem. Next up, we have Gauran Chunjunwala from class 5th A.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Gauran Chunjunwala from class 5th A. Today, I am going to recite the poem, The Porcupine, by Roald Dahl. each Saturday I shout hooray, for that's my pocket money day. This week my parents had been told that I had been as good as gold. So after breakfast, 50p my generous father gave to me. Like lightning down the road I ran until I reached the sweet shop man and bought the chocolates of my dreams, a great big bag of raspberry creams. There is a secret place I know where I quite often like to go. Beyond the woods, behind the rocks, a super place for guzzling chocks. When I arrived, I quickly found a comfy looking little mound, quite clean and round and earthy brown. Just right, I thought, for sitting down. Here I will sit all morning long and eat until my chocks are gone. I sat, I screamed, I jumped a foot. Would you believe that? I had put a tender little rump of mine upon a giant porcupine. My backside seemed to catch on fire. 100 red hot bits of fire. 100 prickles sticking in and puncturing my precious skin. I ran for home. I shouted, Mom, behold the prickles in my bum. My mom, who always keeps her head bent down to look, and then she said, personally, I'm not about to try to pull those prickles out. I think a job like this requires the services of Mr. Myers. I shouted, not the dentist. No. Oh, Mom, why don't you have a go? I begged her twice. I begged her thrice. But grown-ups never take advice. Thank you.
Thank you, Gaurang.
That was truly an amazing performance. Now, I would like to call Artham Singhal from class 5th B.
Hello and good morning to one and all present here. I am Artham Singhal from class 5th B. And I consider myself fortunate to narrate this age-old classic poem, Stopping by the Woods on a Snowy Evening by Robert Frost. Whose woods are these? I think I know. His house is in the village though. He'll not see me stopping here to watch his woods fill up with snow. My little horse must think it weird to stop without a farmhouse near. Between the woods and frozen lake, the darkest evening of the year, he gives his harness bells a shake to ask if there is some mistake. The only other sounds that sweep of easy wind and downy flake. The woods are beautiful, dark and deep, but I have promises to keep and miles to go before I sleep and miles to go before I sleep. I think the poet here is trying to tell that the world has a lot of beauty which we should appreciate but not get distracted by it. We should fulfill promises made as we won't live forever. So, we should learn to prioritize. Thank you.
Wow, Artham, that was an amazing performance. Now, I would like to call Rivansh Agarwal from class 5th B.
Good evening to one and all present over here. Good morning to one and all present over here. I am Rivansh Agarwal from 5th B. Today, I am going to tell Truth from Blacks by Gwendolyn Brooks. And if the sun comes, how shall we greet him? Shall we not dread him? Shall we not fear him? After so lengthy a session with shade, though we have wept for him, though we have prayed, all through this night years, what if we wake one shimmering morning to hear the fierce hammering of his firm knuckles hard on the door? Shall we not shudder? Shall we not flee into the shelter, the dear thick shelter of familiar propitious haze? Sweet is it to sleep in coolness of snug unawareness? The dark hangs heavily over the ice. Thank you.
Thank you, Rivan. That was remarkable. Next up, we have Arohi Bhati from class 5C.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Arohi Bhati from class 5C, and today I'm going to recite a poem. The topic of my poem is equipment. It is written by Edgar A. Guest. Figure it out for yourself, my lad. You have all the greatest of men have had. Two arms, two hands, two legs, two eyes, and a brain to use if you would be wise. With this equipment, they all begin. So start from the top and say, I can. Look them over, the wise and great. They take their food from a common plate, and similar knives and fork they use. With similar laces, they tie their shoes. The world considers them brave and smart. But you have all they had when they made their start. You can trump and come to skill. You can be great if you only will. You are well equipped for the fight you chose. You have arms, legs, and a brain to use. And the man who has risen good deeds to do, begin his life no more than you. Thank you everyone for your precious time.
Wow, Arohi, that was truly remarkable. Now, I would like to call Ipshita Dhama from class 5C.
A very good afternoon to one and all present here. Today, I, Ipshita Dhama, stand beside you to recite a wonderful poem named A Smile's Worth. Here goes the poem. A smile is quite a funny thing. It wrinkles up your face, and when it's gone, you'll never find its secret hiding place. But far more wonderful it is to see what smiles can do. You smile at one, he smiles at you. And so one smile makes two. Smiling is infectious. You catch it like a flu. When someone smiled at me today, I started smiling too. I passed round the corner and someone saw me grin. When he smiled, I realized I passed it on to him. I thought about the smile and then realized its worth. A single smile just like mine could travel round the earth. So if you feel a smile begin, don't leave it undetected. Start an epidemic quick and get the world infected. Thank you everybody for your patience listening.
Wow, Ipshita, that was truly remarkable. Now, I would like to call Maharshi Anajwala from class 5D.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Maharshi Anajwala from grade 5. I'm here to recite the poem written Hope is a Thing with Feathers by Emily Dickinson in 1861. Here it goes. Hope is a thing with feathers that perches in the soul and sings the tune without the words and never stops at all. And sweetest in the gale is heard. And so must be the storm that could abash the little bird that kept so many warm. I have heard it in the chillest land and on the strangest sea. Yet, never in extremity, it asked a crumb of me. Thank you.
That was superb, Maharshi. Next up, we have Kushali Jajur from class 5D.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Kushali Savan Kumar Jaju from grade 5D. Today, I'm going to recite a very inspiring poem written by Douglas Mallock in 1923. Here goes the poem. If you can't be a pine on the top of the hill, then be a scrub in the valley. But be the best little scrub by the side of the hill. Be a bush if you can't be a tree. If you can't be a bush, then just be a bit of the green. Some highway happier make. If you can't be a muskie, then just be a bass. But be the liveliest bass in the lake. We all can't be captains. We've got to be the crew. There's something for all of us here. There's big work to do and there's lesser work to do. But the task we must do is the near. If you can't be the sun, then just be a star. If you can't be an highway, then just be a trail. It isn't by the size that you win or you fail. Thank you.
Wow, Kushali. That poem was truly inspiring. Now, I would like to call Kavya Ranka from class 5E.
Good Good morning to one and all present here. Myself, Kavya Ranka from Class 5A. Today, I am going to recite a poem by Douglas Mallock, namely, Be the Best of Whatever You Are. Here goes the poem. If you can't be a pine on top of the hill, be a scrub in the valley, but be the best little scrub by the side of the hill. Be a bush if you can't be a tree. If you can't be a bush, be a bit of the grass and some highway happier make. If you can't be a muskie, then just be a bays, but the liveliest bays in the lake. We can't all be captains. We've got to be crew. There's something for all of us here. There's big work to do and there's lesser to do. But the task we must do is an ear. If you can't be a highway, then just be a trail. If you can't be the sun, be a star. It isn't by size that you win or you fail. Be the best of whatever you are. Be the best of whatever you are. Thank you.
Now we'll surely be the best of whatever we are. Navya Goyal from class 50, the stage is all yours.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Navya Goyal from class 5E. Today, I'm going to recite a poem, Hope is the Thing, Daffodils by William Wordsworth. This poem reminds us about the beautiful memories of nature and how they can cheer one in later times through the power of imagination. Let's start the poem. I wandered, lonely as a cloud that floats on high over vales and hills, when all at once I saw a crowd, a host of golden daffodils. Beside the lake, beneath the trees, fluttering and dancing in the breeze. Continue as the stars that shine and twinkle on the Milky Way, they stretched in never-ending line along the margin of a bay. 10,000 saw I at a glance, tossing their heads in sprightly dance. The waves beside them danced, but they outdid the sparkling waves in glee. A poet could not but be gay in such a jocund company. I gazed and gazed, but little thought what wealth the show to me had brought. For oft when on my couch I lie, in vacant or in pensive mood, they flash upon that inward eye, which is a bliss of solitude. And then my heart with pleasure fills and dances with the daffodils. Thank you.
Wow, Navya, you must really love daffodils. Here we reach the end of our poetry contest. Let's again give all our participants the energy they need to shine by clapping and cheering them on. Can we hear it louder? Let us embrace the power of speech, beauty of language, and the transformative potential of words. Together, let us celebrate the art of oratory brilliance and the incredible talent on display here today. But before we begin, let us take a moment to acknowledge the dedication and hard work of our participants. Crafting a compelling speech is no small feat, and each one of our contestants has challenged with grace and determination. I would like to go to the ground rules for all of you. Each participant will have 2 minutes to speak on their selected topic. It will be done on the criteria of content, delivery, language, verbal clarity, and expressions. Nilima ma'am will be keeping the time for them. Our first participant, Vani Lohia from class 6A, is here to ours.
A very good morning to one and all present here. Today, I, Vani Lohia, stand before you to talk about the topic, the mistake I corrected. There is no one perfect here. We all have made one or the other mistakes. But there is no problem making mistakes. All you have to do is learn from your mistake, correct it, and try not to repeat it. These 3 steps will take you to the success. The same way, I also made a mistake and corrected it after a period of time. My mistake was that I spoke really fast, but without thinking. Speaking fast is a good thing, but without thinking can lead me into some problem. So, I thought, why should I not correct my mistake? I determined myself that I'll improve, and that determination really showed up. And I even got a lesson that from now, I'll correct my mistakes. Mistakes are a part of life, and we should always learn from our mistake, as each mistake teaches you something new about yourself. There is no failure except no longer trying. So, I would like to conclude with a beautiful thought. Making mistakes is better than faking perfection. Thank you.
That was indeed a beautiful thought. We have a participant named Madhvi Daga from class 6A. She isn't here with us as she is unwell. Next up, we have Yancy Garg from class 6A.
Peace begins with a smile. These words by Mother Teresa perfectly encapsulate the profound impact a simple smile can have. A very good afternoon to one and all present here. I am Yancy Garg from class 6A, and today I want to discuss the incredible power of a smile and how it can truly win a million hearts. A smile is a universal language understood across cultures, languages, and borders. It's a small gesture, but it carries a huge impact. When we smile, we not only uplift our own spirits, but also brighten the lives of those around us. Imagine walking into a room where everyone is smiling. The warmth and positivity are almost tangible. It's like an invisible force that binds us together in a moment of shared humanity. One of the most remarkable aspects of a smile is its contagious nature. When we smile at someone, they are likely to smile back. It can turn a bad day into a better one and provide comfort in times of distress. Moreover, smiling has numerous health benefits. When we are smiling, we are not just spreading joy to others, we are also taking care of our own well-being. At last, I would like to give you a closure with the critical thinking. And that is, think about the people in your life who have left a lasting impression on you with a great smile. Thank you.
Audience, are you thinking about the people who lasted an impression on you? Next up, we have Miraya Thakur from class 6B.
Good afternoon, everyone. Today, I, Miraya Thakur, want to talk to you all about something that we all experience. Mistakes. Mistakes are actions that don't produce the desired results. They occur when we experiment or we have had a lapse in concentration. Making mistakes is a normal process of learning and growing up. It's how we conclude what works and what doesn't. But the most important thing about making mistakes is what we do after we make them. That's when we have to show character, gather the learnings, make corrections, and try again. It's not about how hard you can hit. It's about how hard you can get hit and still stand up. That's how you decide the winner. Talking about mistakes, I would like to share a very important anecdote of my own life. A few months back, I always used to prioritize some of my friends, even when they used to tyrant me, body shame me, and try to bring me down. They made me feel small and inconsequential. But I realized that I was making a mistake by not standing up for myself. Instead of their letting their words hurt me, I decided to focus on what I love doing. I started spending more time on myself, sharpening my skills and adding new ones to my armory. All this while, who kept me going on was my mom. She clapped so loud for me that I never noticed who didn't. Through this experience, I learned an important lesson. Thank you, Mom. Mistakes are not just things we do wrong. They are opportunities to grow. It's a chance to improve ourselves and become stronger. If we would have never made mistakes, we would not know how to do things right. So it's okay to make mistakes and use them as stepping stones to success. Lastly, I would like to conclude by saying, you are strong when you know your weaknesses. You are beautiful when you appreciate your flaws. But you are the wisest when you learn from your mistakes. Thank you.
Wow, Miraya, that was really amazing. Next up, we have Priyana Batra from class 6B. Priyana will also be speaking on the topic, the mistake that she corrected.
Oh no!
What have I done?
Hello?
What have I done? How could have I made such a big mistake?
Don't we all react strongly when we make a mistake?
Yes, we do. But reacting emotionally in itself is a mistake. Instead of reacting, we should think of a solution to the problem and be calm. A very good afternoon to my respected teachers and parents, our honorable judges, and my dear friends. Today I, Priyana Batra, stand before you to share my personal experience on how I learned from a mistake that I corrected. Everyone at some point in their life has made a mistake. Growing up, I was always taught to own up to my mistakes and take responsibility for my actions. However, when I look back into my past, I see many mistakes that come to my mind. Still, there is one instance that I still regret at the thought of, and it taught a valuable lesson to always prioritize your time wisely and be sincere towards all your responsibilities. When I was in third grade, I had a habit of procrastinating. I had a very casual approach towards my studies. My term exams were approaching, but I was very lenient to start preparing. My mother kept reminding me to start studying, but I kept telling her, "Oh, Mama, I will start tomorrow." When my term exams finally approached, I had started studying just 5 days before and wasn't prepared at all. Due to my lack of concentration and preparation, I had underestimated the extent of my syllabus and lost 9 marks in my SS exam. What hurt me the most wasn't that I scored less, but that I knew that I could have done way better if I had started studying earlier. My lack of preparation had cost me dearly. I reached home, started crying, and blamed myself. In hindsight, I realized that I shouldn't have reacted that way. My mother explained to me that crying won't help now. All I could do was start preparing for my next exam and give it my best. So that day, I realized that mistakes are not failures, but life lessons, and promised myself to never repeat this mistake ever again. To conclude, I would like to say, mistakes are not failures, but opportunities to learn and grow. Thank you.
Wow, Arohi, that was amazing. But we agreed to say that your speech exceeded 2 minutes. Yes. Who's the next participant? Can we have a big round of applause for the next participant?
Next up, we have Arushi Bhaskar from class 6C. Before she begins, I would like to tell you that she won the CBSE Buddy competition last year, 2022-23. All the CBSE schools have recognized her. Can we have a round of applause for her? Louder, please. You may begin, Arushi.
The mic. Hello everyone, a pleasant afternoon to all of you. Respected IIT Principal Ma'am, distinguished guests, teachers and my dear friends. I would like to convey that happiness is contagious, so smile big. Today I, Arushi Adeshbaska from grade 6C, got an amazing opportunity to talk about the topic, A Smile Can Win a Million Hearts. Let me start by a request. Can you all give a beautiful smile to the person sitting next to you? How do you all feel? Happy, right? Every little smile can touch someone's heart. No one is born happy, but all of us are born with the ability to create happiness. A smile is a universal language that transcends borders and cultures. A smile can make someone feel welcomed, appreciated, and loved. It can also break down barriers and bring people together. It knows no prejudice. Moreover, smiling has a positive impact on our lives as well. When we smile, our brain releases endorphins that makes us feel good. In fact, World Smile Day is celebrated on first Friday of October all over the world to help people smile and encourage act of kindness. So the next time you see someone, why not give them a beautiful smile? Last but not the least, I would like to conclude my speech by remembering our former Indian president, Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam's words. Always wear a smile because your smile is for many a reason for others to smile. Thank you.
Now we'll truly always wear a smile on our faces. Next up, we have Ishika Vaidyan from class 6C.
As rightly quoted by the American author Phyllis Diller, A smile is a curve that sets everything straight. They say a smile can win a million hearts. Good morning, everyone. I'm Ishika Vaidyan, and today I'm here to tell you why a smile is more than just a beautiful sentiment. Firstly, a smile is contagious. When you smile at someone, it triggers their brain to release endorphins, the chemicals that make them feel happy. Think about it. Have you ever been in a bad mood only to have your spirits lifted up by a smile from a friend or even a stranger? That's the magic of a smile. Moreover, a smile transcends barriers. It doesn't matter what language you speak, what culture you belong, or what background you come from. A smile is universally. Psychologically, a smile can work wonders for your own well-being. Studies have shown that the act of smiling can reduce stress, lower blood pressure, and even strengthen your immune system. And the emotional impact of a smile is huge. In times of hardship or sorrow, a smile from a loved one can be incredibly comforting. One of the most inspiring examples of the power of smile is the story of Mother Teresa. She dedicated her life helping the poor and the sick, and she always did so with a smile. Her smile was a beacon of hope and love, touching the hearts of countless people and inspiring them to follow her. Now, sharing a personal tidbit, whenever I want to get things done by my parents, especially my dad, asking politely but with a sweet smile always fetches a positive reaction. So dear friends, a smile is a small act with a big impact. So let's stretch to smile more often and make our world a more happier and connected place. As Dolly Parton puts it, if you see someone without a smile, give them one of yours today. Thank you.
Do you also do this with your parents? Give them a sweet smile and get everything you want?
Thanks, sir.
Next up, we have Jia Vaidya from class 6C.
Good afternoon to our director, principal, ma'am, our judge, teachers, parents, and my dear friends. Today, Jia Vaidya from class 6C is going to talk about making the most out of your time. Do you think you have enough time? I think the biggest mistake which everyone makes is that you think you have ample of time. Time is free, but it is priceless. You can't own it, but you can use it. And once it's lost, you can never get it back. We always wish to have more hours in a day, isn't it? But it's impossible to attain. As a student in this competitive world, I have to be an all-rounder. I have to study, dance, play sports, do art and craft, be spiritual, take part in competitions, and many more. I feel there is no way to keep up. Fortunately, you can control this situation. But how? The key is not to just manage your time, but to maximize it. Maximizing your time means getting the most out of your time. You can do more with less. Now the question is, how to maximize your time? We all live in a world where many things distract us, especially our mobile phones, which shift our focus away from our work. The first thing which we all should do is go to the calendar and set our short and long-term goals. Accordingly, set your priority list based on urgency. While we are performing our tasks, we should follow the strategy of 5 Ds. Do it. Don't procrastinate your tasks. Delegate it. Shift the task to someone else. Delete it. Delete unimportant tasks. Decide it. Decide fast and move on. And date it. Give a date and time to specific tasks. At the end of the day, introspect yourself and ask, have you spent your day effectively? Implementing these strategies bring amazing results. Therefore, it helps to live a balanced life of freedom, satisfaction, and happiness, without which life is meaningless. Making the most out of your time results in commitment to excellence, intelligent planning, and focused efforts. Thank you very much.
I hope everyone will follow the 5 Ds now. Will you? Can we have a louder answer? Next up, we have Anika Bhatia from class 6D.
Use your smile to change the world. Don't let the world change your smile. Good afternoon, everyone. Today, I, Anika Bhatia of class 6D, stand before you to share a speech on a smile can win a million hearts. A smile, this simple gesture, transcends language and culture, connecting us on a fundamental human level. Imagine a tough day brightened by a stranger's smile. It's a powerful reminder of our shared humanity. A smile conveys empathy, compassion, and kindness, making others feel valued and seen. It benefits both the giver and receiver, releasing endorphins that reduce stress and enhance mood. Great leaders like Mother Teresa recognized its power, emphasizing how small acts of kindness can inspire change and bring people together. In our daily lives, we have countless opportunities to harness the power of a smile. Whether it's greeting a neighbor, thanking a friend, or simply acknowledging a passerby, a smile helps us to make a more compassionate and connected world. So, let us embrace the power of a smile. Let us recognize its ability to transcend differences and touch hearts. Remember, a smile costs nothing, but has the potential to change everything. Together, through the simple act of smiling, we can create a wave of goodwill that reaches far and wide, winning a million hearts along the way. Thank you.
Wow, Anika. Now we will surely give a smile to one another. So now I would like to call Arhan Patel from Class 6D.
In chapter 11, verse 32, in the Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna reveals himself as time, underscoring that time is a powerful force which governs the entire universe. Until you don't value yourself, you will not value your time. And until you don't value your time, you will not value anything you do. It is rightly said by Metric Peck, "Good afternoon, everyone, respected dignitaries, and my dear friends. Today, I, Arhan Patel from Class 6D, will be delivering a speech on how to make the most out of your time. Making the most out of your time is all about being intentional and purposeful. It's how you choose to spend each moment. Time management is not all about getting work done, but it's how you choose to prioritize what truly matters to you and aligning your actions with your goals and values. Another effective way of making the most out of your time is by setting clear and achievable goals, which will bring you closer to your objective. We all can do this, but we need to avoid procrastination. Another key aspect is avoiding distractions. In today's world of life, there are many distractions like YouTube, Instagram, WhatsApp, video games, and other unnecessary interruptions. Time is a valuable resource, and if we use it effectively, we can have a huge performance in our life. I would like to end this speech by saying how I make the most of my time. I like to read the newspaper because it gives me knowledge about current affairs. Thank you for your valuable and precious time for listening to me. Thank you.
Wow, Gia. I can't believe that was the last of the speeches. I want to hear more.
Sure, we are about to witness the incredible talents and spontaneous speaking skills of our fellow students of grade 7th. Are you ready for this exciting and inspiring day?
Absolutely, Gia. Extempo is all about thinking on your feet, expressing your thoughts clearly, and persuading your audience. It's a true test of creativity and quick thinking. We can't wait to see what our participants have in store for us.
Before we begin, let's quickly go over the rules. Each participant was given a topic and an hour to prepare. As you saw at the starting, the seventh graders had taken the chit of topics. Our participants were so talented that they crafted a speech in just an hour. Now they will deliver a speech for about 2 minutes. Judges will be evaluating based on content, delivery, and overall impact. It will be based on the following criteria: language, delivery, content, verbal clarity, and expressions.
Vandana ma'am will be handling the time for us. Let's be here for the first participants. Deva Varaiya from class 7th A. Can we have a round of applause?
It's not all what matters where we end up. It is a journey which is all along the way. Good morning, everyone. Today, I, Deva Varaiya from class 7th A, is here to elaborate on the topic, journey is more important than the destination. Like a mountain climber, where we climb, it's not about reaching the summit. It's about the experiences we go along the way, the challenges, the moment of doubt. Aiming like the student which aims to graduate, it's not only the diploma is important, but the late night sessions, the studies, the friendships we make is also very important. The focus on the journey is also important. It's not only what matters, the destination is. Learning along the way shapes you and your personality. Thank you.
Definitely, Deva, it definitely shapes our personality. Next up, we have Ziana Vagasia from class 7th A.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Ziana Vagasia, and today I'm going to be discussing on the topic that sparks endless debates on the educational circles. Is homework beneficial or detrimental for the students' studies? Now, rightly said by Albert Einstein that you say I forget, you teach I remember, and you involve me, I learn. Now, homework intends for the student to learn even outside the walls of the school. So homework helps us practice what we have learned throughout the day at our home. But every coin has two sides. Like, if homework includes excessive, if homework is excessive, or like the homework includes written memorizing of sums or mugging up of answers, then all the students have every right to have a negative attitude towards it. Because if there is a lot of homework, then at home students will be like spending all their time on their homework, and they won't be able to do any physical activities. They won't be able to like do anything else. So the homework should be like, there is a limit for everything. So the homework should be less, it should be useful, and it should always be on what the child needs. So I'd like to conclude by saying that homework can be good or bad, but it depends on what they give for our homework. Thank you.
That was absolutely amazing, Ziana. I can't believe that these participants can craft their speech in such a short time. Even I can't do that. Who's up next, Gia?
Next up is Sachi Desai from class 7th B.
Good afternoon to the ladies, gentlemen, family and friends present over here. Today, I, Sachi Desai, will be giving a small extempore on the topic, to err is human, while to forgive is divine. We have all heard this statement before, and it is penned by the poet Alexander Pope. It contains the truth about humanity and the grace of forgiveness. All of us here at the point have made mistakes, stumbled, and fell short for expectations. But when we are forgiven, we feel relieved, grateful, and a sense of happiness in us which we have never felt before. To forgive is to remove a burden of anger and hurtfulness from another person. It is a gift that we give to someone and also to ourselves. Forgiveness is the divine answer to a question. And also, when we forgive, it makes us feel. It gives us a sense of happiness from inside. I would like to conclude by saying, to forgive is to set a prisoner free and discover that the prisoner was you. Thank you.
It's okay, Sachi, but forgiveness is definitely something that frees a prisoner.
Next up, we have Sanvika Agarwal from class 7th B.
Good morning to one and all present here today. I, Sanvika Agarwal of class 7th B, is here in front of all of you to share my opinions on the world, on the topic how journey is better, is more important and better than a destination. For example, have you ever heard the saying that journey is better than a destination? Well, if you have not, I'll tell you what does this meaningful sentence mean. For example, when you're going on the top of a hill to hike, and then over there, the top of the hill is your destination, but the journey to reach that destination is the journey where you see beautiful scenarios and birds chirping, and you even make many more friends. This is a place where you can even go through a lot of good things, but obstacles never stop. So there are many obstacles such as rocks, steep slopes, and you even learn how to navigate a path. These journeys even teach you a lot of stuff, like being patient, also agreeing to others, and how to read a map. This teaches us a lot of things. Similarly, in school or a working place, when you are doing something, so the journey to the journey to the goal of yours is the journey where you learn many things, and the goal is the thing, the place where you all meet up. And these things, when you learn in the journey, what you learn in the journey are always secured in your mind and always stay there with you lifelong. Thank you.
Wow, Sanvika. A journey is truly an adventure to reach the destination. Now, I would like to call Amulya Agarwal from class 7C.
Parents and judge, I wanted to be considerate of the students here. They have prepared a speech in almost an hour. It's really difficult for anyone to do so. Can we have a huge round of applause for them? Even the students at the back, please.
Climate change is no longer a far-off thing. It is happening here. It is happening now. A very good morning to one and all present here. Today, I, Amulya Agarwal from 7C, is here to share my views on the topic. Is climate change the greatest threat to our planet? Well, yes, certainly. Climate change is one of the greatest threats to our planet. It affects various parts of the globe and various aspects of our lives. Well, worry not, my friends, because you all know the function of the three R's, right? Reduce, reuse, and recycle. So we should reduce our waste at home. We should reuse it, like reusing the banana peels and other peels of fruits and vegetables can make a really good manure and fertilizer for your plant. This type of fertilizer is very natural and is also good. Apart from that, you can recycle your old plastic bottles and use it to make piggy banks and other such stuffs. This also gives you an opportunity to become more creative. And apart from that, here are some of the effects of climate change. The record-breaking heat waves and the intensifying storms. These are some problems that are faced by climate change. And if we all come together and stand together to control it, then we can certainly control climate change. So let us remember the words of Benjamin Franklin. If you are failing to prepare, you're preparing to fail. So let us all stand together in unity and let us stand together to control climate change. Thank you.
We will definitely stand together to control the climate changes that are happening.
Next up the line is Neva Patel from class 7C.
Good afternoon to one and all present here. Today, I, Neva Patel from class 7C, is going to talk about opportunity comes only once. Today, I would like to talk about the concept opportunity comes only once. Imagine you're standing on the edge of a beautiful river and you see a boat passing into the river. You have a choice. You either sit in the boat and see where the boat takes to you, or you sit on the shore and letting the boats and the possibilities drift away. Just like the river currents, sizing opportunities like willing and prepared to act. Sizing opportunities and prepared to act helps you to chance in advance to your career, pursue passion, and makes meaningful connection. The hesitation makes the difference between success and regret. If an opportunity is coming to your door, don't refuse it. Take the opportunity and move forward. Thank you.
Our school believes that the children should be street smart. So that's really good that the participants here can just pick up the chit and prepare the speech in minutes. Next up, we have Navya Ahuja from class 7th D.
Good afternoon to one and all present here. Today, I, Navya Ahuja of class 7D, is going to talk about a phrase holding a deep meaning and wisdom. To err is human, to forgive is divine. To err is human. We all know when we make mistakes how it feels, from smaller ones like spilling drink to the larger ones like hurting someone we care about. Mistakes are an inevitable part of our life. Think about learning a new skill like playing an instrument or mastering a sports. Mistakes are just not expected. They are the necessary steps of the path to improvement. To forgive is divine. Forgiveness, on the other hand, is a challenging and more challenging endeavor. When we forgive someone, we just not let it go or forget that it happened. Let it go that what was on us. Forgiving is a noble act. In conclusion, to err is human, to forgive is divine. To make mistakes is naturally. To forgive, that is a noble act. So let's try being more forgiving and make our world a bit higher. Thank you.
You're right, Navya. Mistakes are just a part of life.
Before we continue with the competition, I would like request the parents to keep their phones on silent so we can continue.
Next participant is Pratham Girvani from class 7D. Can we please have a huge round of applause for him?
Good afternoon, one and all present here. Today, I, Pratham Girvani of class 7D, is going to say on the topic corruption and its effects on human rights. So, what is corruption? We define corruption as leading discrimination to poverty, thereby creating inequality. What are the causes of discrimination in human. So we have usually seen in the movies that human rights are not human rights are hampered, and this creates an inequality beyond them. This creates a rift between them and they are they think that they won't give them rights either. Thank you.
Wow, I really appreciate that students are able to say on their own and just in a few minutes instead of copying.
Next up, we have Riyansh Javar from class 7th E.
The clap should not go down, audience.
Even the students at the back, you seem to have less energy today. Come on, show the energy. Louder, please. That sounds pretty good.
Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon to one and all present here. Today, Riyansh Javar is going to share on the topic, is homework beneficial or detrimental for students? Homework can be beneficial, as less homework can help students manage time and use their homework can be beneficial for students as it helps them to manage time, do work, and carry out all the education for them. But homework can also be detrimental, as more homework can hamper time for family rest, and also does not leave us with time for other co-curricular activities. So the conclusion is that all the educators who are present here give homework in a limit that the student is able to complete in time, but also has some time for family rest and other curricular activities. Thank you.
That was absolutely an amazing performance, Riyansh. Drishti, now next up the line is Drishti Agarwal from class 7th E. The stage is yours.
A very good morning to our honorable chief guest, my dear teachers, parents, and principal ma'am. Today, I am going to share my opinions on, is climate change the greatest threat to our planet? Climate change is the global threat to our environment. It impacts economics and healthcare to our system. Addressing climate change international corporations and environment act now environment save environment for future. Thank you.
That was really good, Drishti. We draw the curtains on this competition and move on to another.
Let's go through the hallowed halls of Shakespearean drama, a realm where love, betrayal, ambition, and tragedy intertwine in the tapestry of timeless tales.
I would like all the students to be quiet and pay attention to the monologues that you're going to see now. As we delve in the depths of the bard's brilliance, we shall engage in a spirited debate where wit and wisdom shall clash like swords upon the stage. Wait, Gia, did you know that Shakespeare was once known as the Bard of Evans?
Oh yes, how could I forget? It totally slipped out of my mind. Without further ado, let's raise the curtain on our first monologue. It's based on these criteria: introduction, expression, voice, costume, and presentation.
Our first participant is Atharva Rajgaria from class 8A, playing Anthony from Julius Caesar. Can we have a round of applause for him? Yeah.
Greetings to Directive Principal Ma'am, Honorable Judges, respected teachers, cooperative parents, and my fellow mates. Me, Atharva Rajgarhia from Class 8A, is going to present a monologue on Marcus Antonius' famous speech known as the Forum Speech. Today I bring before you not mere words, but not raw emotion and truth of Caesar's death. Allow me to embody the grief and resolve of a man betrayed as I present to you a piece of an act that has been echoing through the ages. Friends, Romans, countrymen, lend me your ears, as I have come to bury Caesar, not to praise him. The evil that men do lives after them. The good is oft interred with their bones. So let it be with Caesar. The noble Brutus had told you Caesar was ambitious. If it were so, it was a grievous fault, and grievously had Caesar answered it. Here under leave of Brutus, and for Brutus is an honorable man, so are they all honorable man. Come I to speak in Caesar's funeral. He was my friend, faithful and just to me. But Brutus says he was ambitious, and sure Brutus is an honorable man. He hath brought many captives home to Rome, whose ransom did the general coffers fill. But Brutus says he was ambitious. When that the poor have cried, Caesar hath wept. Ambition should be made of sterner stuff. You all did see that on the Lupercal I thrice presented him a kingly crown, which he did thrice refuse. Was this ambition? I am not here to disprove what Brutus spoke, but I am here to speak for what I do know. You all did love him once, not without cause. What cause withholds you then to mourn for him? Oh, judgment, thou art fled to brutish beasts, and men have lost their reason. Please bear with me, as my heart is there, buried with Caesar in the coffin, and I must pause till it comes back to me. But yesterday the word of Caesar might have stood against the world. Now lies he there, and none so poor to do him reverence. O masters, if I were disposed to stir your hearts and minds in mutiny and rage, I shall do Brutus wrong, then Cassius wrong, who you all know are honorable men. But before them, I shall wrong the dead, I will wrong myself, and I will wrong you. Then I will wrong such honorable men. Here is the parchment with the seal of Caesar. I found it in his closet. This is will. Let but the commons hear this testament, which, pardon me, I do not mean to read. And they would go and kiss dead Caesar's wounds and dip their napkins in his sacred blood and also beg a hair of him for memory, bequeathing it as a rich legacy unto their issue. And so, dear teacher, this was how Mark Anthony convinces the mass about the brutal murder of Caesar. Thank you.
That was amazing, Atharva.
Next up is Yesha Barasara as Juliet from Romeo and Julius.
Audience, I would request you to keep quiet and listen to the monologue quietly.
Good afternoon, one and all present over here. Today, I, Yesha Barasara, representing as Juliet Capulet from Romeo and Juliet. Juliet, innocent yet transforming from innocence to strength as she falls deeply in love with Romeo. So let's delve into her words. The clock struck 9 when I did send a nurse. In half an hour she promised to return. Perchance she cannot meet him, that's not so. Oh, she's lame. Love's herald should be thoughts which 10 times faster glide than the sun's beam, driving back shadows over lowering hills. Therefore do nimble pinions doves drawn love, and therefore hath the wind swift cupid wings. Now is the sun upon the highmost hill of this day's journey, and from 9 till 12 is 3 long hours, yet she has not come. Had she affections and warm youthful blood? she would be as swift in motion. My words would bandy her to my sweet love and his to me. But old folks many feign as they were dead, unweirdly slow, heavy, and pale as sleet. Oh God, she comes! Oh honey nurse, what news? Thank you.
That was truly amazing, Yasha. Now, next up the line is Raisha Jain as Portia from Merchants of Venice.
Good afternoon, respected judges, teachers, and dear friends. There used to be a girl in class 8C called Raisha Jain, but today she's transformed herself into Portia. The enigmatic character from William Shakespeare's play, The Merchant of Venice. She is the wealthy heiress of Belmont and the romantic interest of Bassanio, who's Antonio's friend. She impersonates as a lawyer in order to save Antonio's life of the consequences of his contract with Shylock. You see me, Lord Bassanio, where I stand, such as I am, though for myself alone. I wouldn't be ambitious in my wish. I would wish myself much better. Yet, for you, I would be trebled 20 times, 1,000 times more fair, 10,000 times more rich. And that only to stand high in your account. I might in virtue, beauties, livings, friends exceed account. But the full sum of me is sum of something which to term in gross is an unlessoned girl, unschooled, unpracticed. Happy in this, she's not yet so old. But she may learn happier than this. Happiest of all is that her gentle spirit commits itself to yours to be directed. As from her lord, her governor, her kings, myself and what is mine to you and yours is now converted. For now I was the master of my servants, queen o'er myself, and even now. But now this house, these lords, and this myself, it's all yours, my lord, which I give away with this ring, which when you part, lose, or give away, let it be the presage of the ruin of your love and be my vantage to exclaim on you. Portia in the court. The quality of mercy is not strained. It droppeth as the gentle rain from heaven. Upon the place beneath, it is twice blessed. It blesseth him that gives and him that takes. This mightiest in the mightiest it becomes. His throne monarch better than his crown. His scepter shows the force of temporal power, an attribute to awe and majesty, wherein doth sit the dread and fear of kings. But mercy is above the scepter's sway. It is enthroned in the hearts of kings. It is an attribute to God himself. And earthly power doth then show like his gods when mercy seasons justice. Therefore, Jew, though justice be thy plea, consider this. None of us should see salvation, for we do pray for it. And that same prayer doth teach us all to render the deeds of mercy. I have spoken thus much to mitigate the justice of thy plea, which if do follow the strict court of Venice, must needs give sentence against the merchant there. Through the above arguments, Portia succeeds in saving Antonio's life by her sharp wit and intelligence and proves that she is the real hero of the play. Thank you.
Can we have one more round of applause for her?
Even the students at the back.
That was truly captivating. Now, I would like to call Aradhya Baed as Lady Macbeth from Macbeth.
Good afternoon to Director, Principal, Ma'am, esteemed judges, and all my dear friends. I am Aradhya Baed from Class 8D, and I will be performing a monologue from Act 1 and Scene 5 as Lady Macbeth from Macbeth. I chose this piece because I was really interested to see whether Shakespeare really does subvert Lady Macbeth as a role of a woman. In the early 1600s, women were seen as a weaker sex, and were portrayed as such in the most contemporary plays. Even in law, women were first seen as literally the their fathers and then their husbands. They did not have a strong voice in society. However, Lady Macbeth in this scene defies the weak woman stereotype as she's strong, acts independently, and is also seen as more domineering than her warrior-like husband. In this scene, she has just received a letter from her husband outlining the witch's prophecy that she will be queen. By extension, of course, he will be king. In this scene, she's seen calling out to the evil spirits to exchange her woman qualities represented by the parts of her body such as her breast milk and her womb and exchange it for male strength so that she can be strong enough to take part in regicide, the ultimate sin. Of course, it's great fun acting out what I certainly feel about Lady Macbeth's thrill and excitement at committing wicked acts. I also want to convey that Lady Macbeth is secretly vulnerable and afraid deep down. She is afraid that God will see her, and she is also afraid of the magnitude of calling up the devil. Act 1, Scene 5. Lamista, what? And Kodor? And shat be what thou art promised. Yet do I fear thy nature. It is too full of the milk of human kindness to catch the nearest way. Art not with that ambition, but with the illness should attend it. What thou wouldst totally, what thou wouldst not play false, yet thou wouldst wrongly win. Hi, Vader, the time I pour my spirits into thine ear and chastise with the valor of my tongue, all that impedes thee from the golden crown which fate and metaphysical aid don't see to crown withal. The raven himself is hoarse that croaks the fatal entrance of Duncan under my battlements. Come, you spirits that tend on mortal thoughts, unsex me here from my crown to the toe top full with direst cruelty. May take my blood and stop up the axis and passage to remorse that no compunctious visitings of nature shake my fell apart or keep peace between the effect and it. Come to my woman's breast and take my milk for God, you murdering ministers. Wherever in your sightless substances you are on nature's mischief, come, take night and pour thee in the dunnest smoke of hell, that my keen knife nor see the wound it makes, nor heaven peep through the blanket of the dark to cry, hold, hold. Thank you.
That was amazing, Aradhya. Now, next up is Kavya Huria as Hermia. The stage is yours. Can we have a round of applause for her?
A zestful noon to my respected teachers, the principal and my honourable guest. Today, I, Kavya Huria, is going to present a monologue on Midsummer's Night Dream, the role of Hermia. I will be performing two scenes. So to begin with, let me introduce you to the character of Hermia. Hermia was the daughter of Aegis. She was in love with a boy named Lysander. But the problem was, she was betrayed by her own best friend. Her best friend herself was in love with Lysander. So let's see how the monologue goes on. Act 3, Scene 2, the role of Hermia. Now I betray, but I should use the worth, for thou, I fear, hast given me cause to curse, if thou hast slain Lysander in sleep, being or shoot or blood plunged in the deep, and kill me too. The sun was not so true until the day as he to me, but he hath stolen away from sleeping Hermia. I'll believe, as soon as this whole earth may be born, and that the moon may to the center creep, and so this peace but is known side of the antipodes, it cannot be but thou hast murdered him. So should a murderer look so dead, so grim, so awful? So this was
was the Act 3, Scene 2, and now let's move forward to Act 3, Scene 3, the role of Hermia. Puppet? Puppet? Why so? Eh, that way goes the game. I see. Now, I perceive that she has made us compare between our statues. She has urged her height with her personage, her tall personage, her height. She had to rage with him. And are you grown so high because I'm so low and I'm so dwarfish? How low am I? How low am I, thou painted maypole? Speak. How low am I? I'm not yet so low that my nails can reach unto your thine eyes. So don't you dare do that. You have a very experience before, just reminding you. So this was it for my monologue, and thank you for being a patient just now.
That was really captivating performance, Kavya. Now, I would like to call Meenakshi Vaidyan from class 8D as Lady Macbeth from Macbeth.
A huge round of applause. Can we cheer for her?
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Meenakshi Vaidyan, and today I will be performing the Lady Macbeth monologue from the Shakespearean play Macbeth, Act 1, Scene 5. This scene. After learning the witch's prophecy, Macbeth receives the title of Thane of Cawdor from King Duncan. Becoming Thane of Cawdor was the first part of the prophecy, and this convinces him that the witches might have been telling the truth. Shaken, but fueled by the first hint of desire to be king, Macbeth writes to his wife to inform her of what has happened. Lady Macbeth, who receives a letter at their castle, becomes determined to take the crown by any means necessary. Ahead of the scene, a servant enters and tells her that King Duncan and Macbeth are both travelling back to the castle. She tells the servant to prepare for their arrival, and once he has left, begins the soliloquy. Glams thou art, and quarter, and shall be what thou art promised. Yet do I fear thy nature. It is too full of the milk of human kindness to catch the nearest way. Thou to be great art not without ambition, but without the illness should attend it. What thou wouldst highly, thou wouldst thou hollowly. Wouldst play false, and yet wouldst wrongly win. Thou to have great glamours, that which cries, thou must do if thou have it. And that which thou dost fear to do, then wishest should be undone. Hie thee hither, that I may pour my spirit in thine ear, and chastise with the vile of my tongue all that impedes thee from the golden round, to have fate and metaphysical aid doth seem to have thee crowned with awe. The raven himself is hoarse, that croaks the veil entrance of Duncan under my battlements. Come, you spirits, that tender moral thoughts, unsex me here, and flee me from the crown to the toe-tap fall of direst cruelty. Make thick my blood, tap of the axes in passage to remorse, that no compunctions of the things of nature shake my fell purpose, nor keep peace between the effect and it. Come to my women's breasts, and take my milk for gall, you murdering ministers. Wherever, in your sightless substances, you wait on nature's mischief. Come, thick night, and pelt thee in the dunner smoke of hell, that my keen knife see not the wound it makes, nor heaven peep through the blanket of the dark, cry, hold, hold.
Thank you. That was amazing, Meenakshi.
But now, let's shift our focus to the debate, a clash of intellect and rhetoric that shall determine the fate of our protagonists. Before we move on,
till our team is preparing for the debate, we have a fillers team consisting of Karthik Sharma and Kavang Mangukya to entertain you.
Hello, hello. Welcome, welcome. Today, I, Karthik Sharma, alongside my partner, Kavan Mangukya, have a quiz that's motivating our cat trying to play chess. So let's see who's got the moves. So before we start the quiz, only two answers will be accepted. Kindly choose your answers wisely, and chorus answers will not be entertained. So let's start with the topic, William Shakespeare's. Alright folks, brace yourself for the first question. What is the name of Shakespeare's most famous play? Your options are Hamlet, The Twelfth Night, Julius Caesar, and Romeo Juliet. Those who know the answer, kindly raise their hands, I'll come towards you.
Hello. Yes. What? Romeo and Juliet.
So that's the wrong answer. Kavan, can we take hands from there?
Yes.
Hamlet.
That's the correct answer, ma'am. Can we have a round of applause for ma'am? Over to Kavan for the next question, please.
What is the name of Shakespeare's comedic play about mistaken identity?
Your options are King Lear, Othello, The Comedy of Errors, and The Tragedy of Errors. Can you raise your hands who don't know the answer?
Option number 8.
I'm sorry, but your answer is
Comedy of Errors.
That's the right answer, ma'am. Can you have a round of applause for ma'am? The correct answer is Comedy of Errors. For those who don't know, as the name suggests, the Comedy of Errors is full of mistakes. The comic arises from a series of mistaken identities introduced by two sets of twins, Antipholus of Syracuse and Antipholus of Ephesus, and their servants, Dromio of Syracuse and Dromio of Ephesus. Over to Gwen for the next question, please.
Which character from Shakespeare's play quoted these words? Veni, Vedi, Vici. Options are Cleopatra, Antony, Virat Kohli, and Julius Caesar. That's the correct answer. A round of applause.
Julius Caesar is the one who said this. Put simply, Caesar was highlighting his quick and decisive victory over the Farnaces too, but the phrase had other meanings. The quick, powerful statement signaled not just the Caesar's success of Farnaces, but his success over his predecessors, like Pompey the Great. Can you go to Kavan for the meaning of the quote, please?
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Karthik and Kavan, for taking over.
But now, let's shift our focus to the debate. A clash of intellect and rhetoric that shall determine the fate of our protagonists. Before we move on, I would like to go over the criteria of judgment. Organization and clarity, use of argument, rebuttal, and presentation style. Let the discourse begin. Shall we unravel if social media is benefit for teenagers? The stage is set. The players assemble. Let the games commence. The participants are, for team 1, we have Arohi Pradatka, Sophia Vagasia, Araina Jain, Nishika Choksi, and Anaisha Chhabra, arguing for the motion. For team 2, we have Adya Kampani, Samia Sabu, Nishka Uttam Chandani, Dhruvika Tulsian, and Hitakshi Khaitan going against the motion. Round 1. First, we have team 1 sharing their opinions for the motion. In this round, they will have 30 seconds to share opinions. We have Vandana ma'am for the time.
I am Arohi Aripiratka. On behalf of my team, we strongly believe that social media is beneficial for teenagers.
Social media allows a platform for communication, allowing teenagers to connect with their friends and family. It also raises awareness. Every coin has two sides, believing that social media raises awareness and also helps teenagers showcase their talent and help boost their self-confidence. It's just how you preserve social media. Social media, by raising awareness, has also told us about about a movie, about the movies that are currently happening, which can be very inspirational. Thank you.
Now, we have Team 2 sharing their opinions against the motion. They are also having 30 seconds.
Do you really think you control your minds? If yes, you're wrong. Social media controls your mind. We see pictures of perfect people and want to be just like them. But in reality, they're not perfect. They just act being perfect and they fool us. We idolize them and want to be like them. And then we hide our own selves to be cool on social media. Social media also has non-age appropriate stuff and a lot more which can harm a person's well-being. So let's be social in the real world and not on social media.
Round 2. In this round, each member will get 30 seconds to rebut on the opposing team. In this round, only one person will get to speak at a time and it'll go turn by turn for the two teams accordingly. Let's hear from Team 1.
In today's digital age, social media has been more accessible than ever. Social media platforms like YouTube, Instagram, and TikTok provide a vast canvas for teenagers to share their stories, ideas, and arts. By fostering these skills, we can enhance our capacity to understand ourselves and others, leading to a more empathetic and harmonious society. It also allows teenagers to stay connected with their friends and family.
Now, let's hear from Team 2.
Being successful is not an option but a mandatory task to reduce the usage of social media and to the bare minimum. An example is of PV Sindhu, a world-renowned badminton player. In one of her interviews, which is readily available on YouTube, she stated that she was not allowed to use her phone for social media then more than 5 minutes a day in her extensive training period, as it would disrupt her concentration.
Round 3. This event is still continued.
I would like to raise this thing that it helps us in educational resources, because when you see that it helps us to learn active more than passive learning, and teachers can also video call us and communicate with us. We also have the option to comment on the reels and streams, live streaming, and participate in quizzes, which helps us in the learning process. And we also can video call, game, and see reels, which allow us in our learning progress.
Social media can be very addictive. Like 49.16% of teenagers use social media for just time pass. And Nishika, as you said, it can be used for education. Would you rather trust a stranger that posted something on social media or your teacher and your parents?
You just stated that social media is time of waste, but you can use social media for many other purposes. You can show your creativity in it. You can see dance reels, show your art skills, and even you can learn many other skills from it. Now, my point is that social media helps young people to spread awareness. TikTok, a very growing social media platform with more than 100 million users, and from that, 49% of them are teenagers. Celia, a 16-year-old, has 100 million followers, and her content is about spreading awareness. In 2020,
social media can also act as a platform for cyberbullying and harassment. According to a global survey conducted, about 45% of Indian children who have participated have been cyberbullied by someone they don't know online. In the US, about 14.9% of the children have been cyberbullied, out of which 13.6% have also committed suicide.
I would like to defend, social media has its own pros and cons, but it doesn't mean that you have to use it limitlessly, and you cannot give your private information to anybody online. You cannot trust people with verbal in physical also, so how can you trust a person who is online? Now, I would like to give my point that social media helps teenagers communicate, and social media makes them feel less lonely. If they are not in physically contact with anybody, they depend on social media for their happiness.
Exactly. Nowadays, people are depending on social media for their happiness and they're not even knowing what is going on in their actual life. And social media is just misguiding you. You don't even know the information posted there. Is it even true? Is it even happening? And you're choosing to trust a person whom you don't know. He's just a stranger to you. Your happiness, you're just leaving everybody around you. That's what social media causes. You're just addicted to that platform.
Addiction is also based on the people happening. The news information that is there are also news channels that display the information.
You can create of that. And plus, it's not just about selfies and memes anymore. There are a lot of career opportunities on social media. Influencers, they also do digital marketing that is there. Even teenagers help their parents in digital marketing nowadays. They analyze the data.
So, if you think social media is a reliable career, don't you think universities and colleges would have come up for degrees and PhDs on the same? Social media, social media is a toxic addiction, unfortunately does not have a rehabilitation center. Most teenagers are addicted, and it is a human fact that we like things that entertain us instead of inform us. In a span of 5 hours of studying, you will get distracted 8 times, that is shown by human psychology. But while watching a movie of 3 hours, you won't get distracted once. Thus proved, you like to watch.
We have reached the final round. That is round 3. In this round, we will have open interjecting between the two teams for 3 minutes. Let the discourse begin.
So as you mentioned that it is an addiction to it, right? So if there are, like if you look at a sword, it has 2 parts. One is blunt and one is sharp. So you can, like if you look at social media, you will not get it won't be an addiction to it. Because like if you will be using a right content, it won't become an addiction.
Are you aware that you cannot control 65% of teenagers by www.healthguideorganization are not able to control their time, thus their grades fall and they are a source to loneliness.
But 69% of students feel confident. 69% of teenagers feel confident after using social media. They do not feel down. Social media makes their life feel harder instead of, stressing them out.
Okay, they are feeling confident on a platform. People on social media, they are not your well-wishers. They are just saying whatever they are seeing. People get distracted because of social media. There is cyberbullying, there is hacking.
How did you get to know that people are cyberbullying on social media? Did you get to know that because of social media? Yes. If there was no social media, how would you even get to know? The modern world is here.
Are you aware of Google? The platform which is not social media but contains reliable information. Social media
Google is also a part of social media. You cannot
Google is not a part of social media.
It is
not.
WhatsApp is also a part of social media. You use it to communicate with others.
If Google is not a part of social media, let's tell everybody in the world to stop using Google because then they are getting distracted. What are you doing right now? All of us are getting distracted because of social media. People are commenting on your posts and you are not allowed to comment on Google. Google is there for researching.
Google is there for research. We're talking about the comments that are going on. The person is being affected, right? You're talking about the person being affected, that on the person's basis. Or if the person is thinking they're being affected.
There are three important C's in life. Career, concentration, and comparison.
But
social media is the third C. Comparison. Career and concentration are very much linked.
But career can also be built in social media.
As I stated previously, social media is not a reliable career.
It is reliable. So much information is
social media is giving you unrealistic expectations. You're comparing your life with the people out there. You're comparing yourself with the celebrities.
Time's up.
In conclusion, we would like to say that we strongly believe in that social media is beneficial for teenagers. Social media helps teenagers to show their creativity, stay connected, and provides abundant educational resources. People nowadays consume more data than food. So how can it be total evil spirit?
To conclude, I would like to say, you all mentioned that cyberbullying, you get to know about social media. But you didn't comment on the fact that cyberbullying and harassment does happen, and a major majority of happens because of social media. Younger teens who don't know what is happening, they trust anyone who's on the screen and they simply believe it. That too is social media.
Okay, time up. Overall conclusion. Here we adjourn the debate. And till...
Just a minute, students. Listen. The debate is over. I have a question to both the teams. The 10 people who are here, first of all, pick up your hand who is not using this social media at all. Second thing is, as one of my students said, that a sword has a blunt and a sharp side. So you cannot get away from it because you have been born in this era where technology will take you to miles. But then this blunt and sharp, you have to decide. You don't be blunt and just go on copying blindly things, but you have to be sharp enough to understand that which part of social media and how much I should be using for my productive growth. That's one point. And the third one is, any one of you, I would say this particular team who says we can be reliable on career, how many of you really want to be influencers only and not any other profession? Okay? And to these people, that influencers at times do let us know what are the things we can adapt for our growth. So, understand the debate was quite good. You were quite good on that, but then as two sides of the coin, use it very, very wisely. Then only you can make your growth. Thank you.
Ma'am, I would like to answer what you just said. Actually, we won't be making a career in the future and be an influencer. But if in the future we like open a company, a business company, so to promote it, we can definitely use social media such as Instagram and Facebook because it will help us a lot in our career and our field. Yes.
And wise use. And this group of teenagers among their peers you should spread.
Yes.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Till the judge is evaluating the scores for us, we will have our fillers team again on the dais.
Welcome back everyone to the quiz. Over to Kavan, please.
Yes, we still have some more questions for you. So let's continue.
So, for the ones who thought we were gone, well, we still have some questions in our bank. So let's start. Over to Kavan for the next question, please.
Which of Shakespeare's play is about ill-fated romance between two young lovers?
As the rules say, no chorus answers, please. Raise your hands when you know the answer. I'll come to you.
Romeo and Juliet.
No options, ma'am.
The answer is correct. A round of applause.
Moving on to the next question. What is the name of Shakespeare's play that explores the theme of jealousy? Kavan, can you go upside, please? I forgot to say that we will not give you options from now on. So kindly adjust with it.
See,
is it Othello?
The answer is wrong.
The correct answer is Othello. Can we get a round of applause for ma'am? Ma'am, one question can I ask you? Do you read William Shakespeare? Oh, that is why. Okay. Moving on to the next question. Over to Kavan, please.
Which Shakespearean play centers around a mischievous fairy named Puck?
Anybody would like to give a try?
A Midsummer Night's Dream.
That's the correct answer.
Can we get a round of applause?
Over to you, Karthik.
Thank you, Kavan. The next question is, women can be ambitious as men and as cruel as men also. Who indicates this behavior in the Shakespearean drama?
Hello.
Macbeth, Lady Macbeth.
The correct answer is Macbeth. Can we get a round of applause for ma'am? Now, most of you might think it is MacBook, but the answer is Macbeth. Over to Gun for the next question, please.
Yes. Which Shakespearean plays features the famous line, all the world's of stage?
Kindly raise your hands if you know the answer. Yes, ma'am.
I think it is Julius Caesar.
No. I'm coming towards you. Don't shout my name.
The question was, which of Shakespeare... No.
No answers? Okay.
Merchant of Venice.
Kavan, is that the right answer?
No, the correct answer is As You Like It. For those who don't know, All the World's a Stage is taken from William Shakespeare's play, As You Like It. These lines are spoken by Jax in Act 2, Scene 7. The opening lines say that all the world's a stage and all the men and women merely play its players. In now, these lines, the poet compares the world to a stage.
Now, before I move on to the next question, I want to tell you that I'll take only two answers from now onwards as we lack of time. So, Kavan, the next question, please.
Wait for a minute, please. So, parents, we have refreshments in the primary assembly room. So, after we are done with the judgments and we have our awards, after the event is over, you can please go there and have refreshments.
Karthik, wait. Enough questions from Shakespeare's has been asked. So, let's move on to the next topic. This topic is all about Indian authors and their achievements. So, the first question is, which renowned Indian poet wrote the collection Gitanjali?
Wait. Before I start with the first question, let me check your personal knowledge. Anybody read books about any Indian author? Kindly share his reviews. Yes, ma'am.
The answer to her question is Rabindranath Tagore. And regarding Indian author, I read a lot of Amish Tripathi. So that is a combination of... I think he's bought Indian history, he's made it like a thriller. So when you read his books, you get a different insight into the Indian history. Like I recently read Ram, Sita and Ravan. And the way he has projected it, at the end of it, I felt that Ravan was the hero of Ramayan. So that is the difference that he brings to it.
Can we get a huge round of applause for ma'am?
And
ma'am also showed his views and also the correct answer for the question which Kavan asked was Tagore. So another round of applause for ma'am.
For the students, we would like to say that please maintain silence. I know you're very curious to answer the questions, but you have to raise your hand and speak.
The next question is, who wrote the epic poem Mahabharata? Kavan, can you go up, please?
Ved Vyas.
The answer is correct.
Can we get a round of applause for Moog? Over to Gun for the next question.
Which Indian poet wrote the famous poem Sarojini?
Huh? Anybody know the answer? Did everybody listen to the question
Sarojini
properly?
Naidu. The answer is correct. It's Sarojini Naidu.
The answer was in its name itself. So, moving on to the next question, over to Kavan, please.
Who is the author of the classic Indian novel, Anandamath?
Rabindranath Tagore.
That's the wrong answer. Try hard next time, please.
Anyone else?
Anybody who knows the answer, kindly raise your hands.
Can we all please maintain silence?
Let me kindly maintain the decorum, please. Can we be silent, guys? Thank you.
Thank you, Phyllis team. The judges are ready with the scores. I would like to call them on the stage so they can share the opinions and
can
the
we
winners.
Get a huge round of applause?
Louder, please.
The claps are going dry. Louder, please.
Over to you, ma'am.
So,
a very good afternoon to all the parents and all everybody present here. Well, I must begin with the fact that I've had a whale of a time watching every single child perform and doing exceptionally well. And I just saw the time in my phone and I realized, oh, it's one. And I didn't even realize it's close to one. I mean, all the performances were so very good. It certainly was hard not to crack for me to be able to decide whom to give first position, second, third, so on and so forth. So to begin with, and not much of your time, I can see children standing here with their fingers crossed, praying to God, right? So I wouldn't want you to hold on for any further. Beginning with the first contest we've had for grade 5, and that was a poem recitation. All the children did, and consider the fact and since all of them did exceptionally well, we have 3 children sharing the first position, 3 sharing the second position, and I assume there's also, and there's 1 child on the third position. And regardless of the fact, whoever is winning, I believe all of them did really well. One thing I would like to specifically mention for all the 5th graders is the amount of confidence they've had when they were here on stage, right? So to begin with, announcing the third position, the one who secured third position for the poem recitation, let's give it up for Vanshika Mehta. Moving on with 3 children sharing second position in the poem recitation. Let's give it up for Gaurang Jhunjhunwala, Rivansh Agarwal, and Maharshi Anajwala. Let's give it up for the 3 of them.
Audience, the clap should not stop.
Moving on with the first position, 3 of them sharing the position again. Let's give it up for Ipshita Dhama, Khushali Jajo, and Kavya Ranka.
Congratulations to all the winners. Can we once again have a huge round of applause for them?
We can continue the claps.
Moving on with grade 6.
The clap should not dry.
Elocution competition. So here, the child who's got the third position. Before that, I believe I was quite astounded with the kind of expressions and the delivery skills each of them had. I believe the most competitive competitions amongst all the slots was certainly the elocution, because each and every child was so very good and there's hardly a difference of 1 or 2 marks here and there for each one of them. So to begin with, the one who secured the third position for elocution, let's give it up for Priyana Patra.
Come on, audience, show some cheer for your friends.
Moving on, the one who stands on the second position, let's give it up for Miraya Thakkar.
the one who has taken and is leading with the first position for elocution. Let's give it up for Arushi Bhaskar. And now moving on with the slot of extempore, one of my very, very, very favorite slots. I believe we must have seen children being a bit nervous here, but trust me when I say this, parents, it's not an easy job to be standing here with that amount of pressure and doing an extempore with the least amount of preparation. I believe the slot which did the best amongst all is certainly, certainly extempore slot. So let's give it up for the ones who took the courage to participate in extempore and of course did spectacular with the performances. So the one who stands at the third position for the extempore challenge, let's give it up for Diva Viraya. The one who stands at the second position, let's give it up for Sanvika Agarwal. And the one who stands at the first position for the extempore, let's give it up for Amulya Agarwal. Moving on, again one of the slots in which all the children astounded me and took me by surprise with the performances, the monologue one. Against the slot which was quite competitive and gave me a tough time in deciding who's gonna be on the first, second and third position. So, calling upon the one who has secured third position for the monologue grade 8, let's give it up for Meenakshi Vaidyan.
Why are the cheers so dry today? Come on, audience!
Moving on, the one who secured the second position for monologue contest, let's give it up for Raisha Jain. And the one, I believe this goes by saying, the one who was very good with most of the criteria set for the monologue, let's give it up for Aradhya Beg.
Clap should be louder, everyone.
And now moving on with grade 8, the debate competition. So the team that has won is certainly the 4 team. So let's give it up for the 4 team. Great counter argument, great rebuttal points and quite well researched, I believe. Right, and I would like to congratulations, girls. I would also like to specifically mention children who are in the against side: Adya Kampani, Samya, Dhruvika, Hitakshi, and Nishka. Adya and Samya, you had great content and good courage to be able to come back with your points, and so did Hitakshi and Dhruvika and Nishka. You were exceptionally good with your, I think, the initial starter opening speeches. So I mean.
Clap should go louder for all the winners.
And before I leave the stage, I would want to have the loudest applause and cheer for the school authorities. I think organizing competitions like that like these is need of the hour, given that the children here in our city need utmost confidence when it comes to being on stage performing. So it's a great platform. You must be thanking your teachers and your principal and the other authorities. Great contest. All the contests that those were arranged, I mean, I love the concepts, I love the ideas, and I thoroughly enjoyed. So thank you so much for giving me this opportunity of being here and witnessing the young orators here. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
now we have the musical curtain call. I would request all the participants and the winners to wait in the wings. At the end, we will be having the group photograph.
Hello.
Now we have a musical curtain call. So people who know the lyrics for the song, kindly join and groove with us.
Events, we are filled with admiration for the talent and dedication each participant has displayed here today.
Your words have not only entertained us, but also inspired and provoked thoughtful reflection. Each performance has been a unique showcase of creativity and expression, reminding us the power of language to connect and transform.
On the behalf of the entire GDGIS, I would like to extend a heartfelt vote of thanks to all the participants, judges, the teachers of the English department, the audience, and the parents for joining us here today, who made our Lit Fest a literally leap the success. Your support and enthusiasm truly elevated the event and made it a memorable experience. For everyone involved, to the talented poets, public speakers, and debaters who showcased their skills and creativity, we are grateful for your dedication and passion for the art of the expressions. Your performances were inspiring and thought-provoking, and we commend you for your hard work and dedication.
We would also like to express our gratitude to the judges for their expertise and fair assessments, to our director principal ma'am for her valuable inputs, middle section coordinator and assistant coordinator for generous contribution that made this event possible. Lastly, to the audience members attended and cheered on the participants, thank you for your support and encouragement. Your presence made a significant impact on the success of the event.